Stephen Roy Goodman, host of Higher Education Today, a production of the University of the District of Columbia. Welcome back to the education program that connects you to contemporary issues, people, and institutions involved in the world of higher education. Today we'll be talking about schools of public health. Dr. Marie Diener-West is chair of the Master of Public Health program at the Johns Hopkins University Bloomberg School of Public Health. Marie's research interests include clinical trials and statistical education. Dr. Alan Herman is an independent public health consultant. Alan was the founding dean of the National School of Public Health at the Medical University of Southern Africa. Welcome to both of you.
Thank you. Pleasure to be here.
Well, thanks for coming on. Maybe if we could start with a very simple question, but I think an important one. What is public health?
Well, I think, you know, I could try to start. There certainly are a number of different definitions, but I know there was one at the turn of the last century that said it's a science and an art, but it's the science and art of preventing disease, promoting health, and prolonging life in an organized community effort. And although we could certainly add the multifaceted and multidisciplinary aspects that the current public health is to that definition, I think that it's important because it helps us distinguish between clinical health and public health. And so if we think clinical health, we think about an individual and an individual's disease status and the direction of looking at diagnosis and treatment. But with public health, we're focusing on a group of individuals. We're focusing on a population.
And that group could be people in a state, in a country, people
a
under
city.
A certain age.
Yeah. I think one of my examples is that at the turn of the century when Johns Hopkins School of Public Health was founded by the great William Welsh, who was also, just parenthetically, the dean of the School of Medicine, the founding dean of the School of Medicine, and the founding professor of the history of medicine at Hopkins. He was also, at that time, the commissioner of public health for the city of Baltimore, and he cleaned up the city's water, because up until that time, people were dying of gastrointestinal disorders caused by drinking foul water. Welsh did a number of things. He educated public health practitioners, and he made the city healthy. So his community was the city of Baltimore. But through the long history that Hopkins has had, they have actually improved the quality of health all over the world. And in my case, in the National School of Public Health, we were dealt with different problems. The School of Public Health started at the beginning of the AIDS epidemic. So our interest was to train people to manage AIDS in communities rather than individuals. But you couldn't do that without having adequate drugs for people who had the disease. So one of the things public health people did was to create policies to have access to medication for people who are HIV positive. So it's a wide range of issues. Today in the United States, the biggest problem is obesity, which will kill people in their 40s, 50s, 60s from heart disease. And so the prevention of obesity may not have a direct and immediate impact on health, but it will have an impact of health, on health 20 years from now.
But then how do you say that to somebody politely? How do you say to someone that you have a better chance of dying if you become obese?
Well, since I brought up the topic of obesity, I'm of the school of public health practitioners that really does believe that you don't threaten people with their risk. You find a way to mitigate behavior through understanding why people do what they do. So for example, in the case of HIV and AIDS, sexual behavior is critical. But you don't then say to people, you know, you're a bad person because you have too many partners. You say to them, this is what happens when you have many partners. These are the issues, and you work towards mitigating behavior rather than finding blame. A lot of newspapers and television programs try to inflate the fear around many risk factors for disease, and I sometimes sit there wondering, don't they actually understand that people will continue to do what they do even when you frighten them? Because the behavior is not driven by fear, it's driven by all sorts of things. So in the case of obesity, what are the issues related to obesity? If you live in the poorest parts of this city, or Baltimore, or the poorest part of any community, or the Delta in Mississippi, which would be a poor rural area, mostly African American, you find that there are not enough good food outlets. You live in a food desert. They call these things food deserts nowadays, and I'm not really like that word because I think it doesn't tell you about the poor food that's not that is available there. So how do we change the context of a person's life in East Baltimore and South DC so that they don't walk past tons of McDonald's and that's what they eat every day, and mommy's at work and you come home and there's a pack of chips and soda that you eat for your afternoon snack because mom hasn't been able to buy fruit and vegetables for you to eat. So that's your context. Are you actually the cause of your obesity or is your context more important? So it's a complicated issue. You can't just sort of find a simple lever. Welsh was fortunate. All he had to do was to clean the water and everybody got healthy. We actually have to find a way to make people behave differently.
And speaking of the behaving, on a university campus, how do we do that? I understand you want to try to convince people that it's in their interest to do X, Y, Z, but what are your classes like in schools of public health to encourage that and to encourage people who are going to become practitioners of public health to then go out into their communities and do that?
So I think actually the graduate students in public health have some of the healthiest diets because they are aware. They're aware of the ramifications that Dr. Herman just talked about. And so, you know, there are times when there are seminars that are given and there's pizza that's served. And the students are the ones who rebel against the pizza because they know that they should be eating healthier foods. So I think it is a balance between the cost and the availability of foods. But I know some universities, our School of Public Health has a community-supported agriculture network, and there are fresh fruit and vegetable markets every week for students to buy, you know, fresh fruits and vegetables and take them home. I think it's a very different issue when you're trying to control a cafeteria, either a school cafeteria or a campus cafeteria, because then the issues of cost and what students may or may not like, especially if they're undergraduates, comes into play.
Yeah, I would agree with that. If you want to change a campus, you actually have to change the thinking of the president of that campus. And in the case of when I started the National School of Public Health, I insisted that part of what has to happen on the campus where there were four faculties was that you go to the cafeteria and there's fresh food and good food. People will still want to eat fried food because that's sort of in our nature. Mm-hmm. We are built to enjoy this kind of food. And an example I'll give you, if you take Aboriginal people in Australia who come from the backwoods, or you take Khoisan people from South Africa who are the hunter-gatherers, and you bring them into a room and you feed and you put on a table fried food, that food would disappear so quickly. Because in fact, we are designed to eat past satiation, because hunter-gatherers had long periods of hunger, and frying food is in fact built into the smell and taste of it is built into the way we think of food from our hunter-gatherer days. So this is a deep, almost ontological urge that we have to eat the kind of food that we do. So when you change diets, you mix it in such a way that people can actually have healthy food, and you teach people not to eat past satiation, because that's sort of inherent. I had an old teacher who used to work on food and water metabolism in Aboriginal people because he was interested in how they managed water when water was scarce. And he told me one day that he put together a sort of buffet and had a few of these people in, and when he came back, there was nothing left. And there were fewer people in that room that would usually eat that amount of food because they thought of they had a sort of sense of non-availability, so they had to eat everything because tomorrow there would not be any food. We don't have that problem. Since the 40s in this country and maybe the 70s and 80s in other countries, agriculture has overproduced food. So we don't actually have a model of scarcity for food. And in the model of overabundance, our behavior is from the savannah, it's hunter-gatherer. So how do you change how people do things when the driving force is savannah-like?
Well, couldn't you change it based on public policy? Like, for instance, the mayor of New York City, if I understand the proposal, is trying to make it illegal in New York to have a certain amount of ounces of diet soda or soda.
Of sugar containing, right, carbonated beverages. And, you know, so I think that part of what, you know, Dr. Herman has given some great examples of public health that shows that it's not just the medical, it's not just the legal ramifications, it's also the social and behavioral aspects. And that's what public health is trying to address, all of them in that continuum. So so that was actually voted down to, and I think that he'll bring that up again if he can, or hopefully somebody else will bring it up. But it came to be an issue of freedom to actually purchase such a large drink, or freedom to eat, you know, or overeat, overconsume such food. But I think that what public health is trying to do is actually address those, not make a law against something, but to address why people are doing something and try to encourage them to change their behavior.
But it certainly has to go into other arenas too. If you think about the economic aspect of this, I mean, somebody who's opening up a McDonald's on a corner isn't doing that because they have nothing better to do. Somebody spent a lot of time thinking about that, whether or not that's going to make money. And McDonald's said, okay, we can do it here because we think people are going to buy McDonald's food.
Yeah, but again, if you take the New York example with the large sodas, or you take the McDonald's example where you put a McDonald's and you make cheap food available to people who don't have enough resources, both of those actually constrain liberty in a very, very real sense. We want public health not to restrict people's liberties. We want public health to give people choices where, through education and choice, you make the best possible decision for your own wellness. If you, in fact, take a public policy which actually constrains liberty, even if it's a good public policy, it will fail because it actually has taken liberty and made it smaller. And in this country where liberty is so critical to the identity of Americans, that idea that Bloomberg had would actually fail because it actually went directly against the nature of what Americans feel themselves to be. But if Bloomberg worked as Clinton did to remove sodas from schools, mm-hmm. Now that is a public policy that's sort of hidden, because you come to your school one day and there's no soda machine anymore. There's a water machine or something else. It constrains your choice, but it doesn't tell you that you cannot. It tells the institution that these are the limits of its behavior. And you can do the same with fast food joints, where you can say, for you to put a fast food joint in a neighborhood, it must be within 100 meters or 200 meters or a mile from a farmer's market. You can actually balance your policy to give people alternatives by giving people the right to do exactly what they want.
That's interesting. Let's assume I was going to set up an exurb of a city somewhere in the Midwest. Would I consult with public health experts on exactly this point? In terms of your point is an interesting one about taking a McDonald's and then taking a farmer's market. Would we write that into the city ordinance?
I think that that's the way to do good public policy, where you say the context that people live in, we will in fact define in a particular way for the greatest health. You also want to say, we want to have streets that have enough walking, walkable streets. Now, Baltimore, for example, is in the top five cities for walkability. DC is nearer the bottom, but it's getting better. So we want to have ideas where health is part of the invisible matrix of a city. You also want not to have high rises where you sort of warehouse people. If you think of Cabrini Green in Chicago, one of the problems of Cabrini Green was it was a warehouse, and violence and negative issues were hidden in this warehouse. So you walk up the staircases, the elevators never worked, and you were confronted by violence in all sorts of ways. When they tore down Cabrini Green and made it horizontal, you changed the nature of the city. So urban planning and public health go together. And I think cities are now starting to get it, but it's still sort of haphazard. It's sort of, you know,
Right, there's not necessarily a plan,
yeah.
But I think that some of the efforts, so Baltimore, for instance, is having more bike lanes, and it's also, so it's encouraging biking. Some of the organizations, the larger companies, are encouraging work near your, live near your workplace. And so, you know, and that can be then an easy bike or a walk. So I agree with Dr. Herman that it needs to be organized, that the planning needs to be at the city level in conjunction with public health experts, but we still have a long way to go to make sure that there is there are city epidemiologists, there are others work both in the city and the state with the health departments, but there still needs to be more concerted efforts in order to enact those changes.
Well, and in terms of those changes, it seems to me that these changes would be difficult because you've always got these political situations going on. Because wouldn't there be an instance when somebody refuses to acknowledge that they're sick or that a community has some sort of disease?
Well, or it could be the other. It could be that a community actually realizes that they appear to have a cancer cluster. And so then, you know, then there's the need to explore whether there is some exposure to a carcinogen that's, you know, resulting in an increased risk. So I think it goes in both ways, goes in both directions.
Well, how would that work? So let's assume that you found, somebody contacts Johns Hopkins and says, you know, there seems to be a lot of people who are getting sick in this community, in this particular place.
So usually that would go to the state health department. So the state health department has epidemiologists, other public health trained individuals in environment and in risk assessment who would actually try to then collect data on, you know, how many cases of cancer are in this particular geographic area, say it's a county. How does that compare to what it had been in the past? How does it compare to the cancer rate that's observed in other counties in the state? So there are, you know, there are mechanisms in place with both city and state health departments. It varies across the states. The quality varies.
Yeah. I think there are two issues. One is that there is a public health structure in most developed countries and even developing countries where you have people whose job it is to look after the health of the community. It's usually the Department of Health that has these people. Sometimes you need to bring university academics into the mix to really understand the problem because it's technically difficult to identify a cancer cluster. It's not the easiest job in the world. It's statistically complicated. And people think that since there are 10 more people in this group than in another, then it's actually important. And one of the great epidemiologists of the 20th century, Sir Richard Dahl, did a lot of work on cancer clusters in children who lived under power lines, and so did Abe Lilienfeld from Hopkins. And so these two giants of epidemiology showed that these cancer clusters were just sort of accidental clusters. They were not real. So that's the one part that the city, the state, the county, all of these places have health officers whose job it is to look after the health of the community. The larger issue is there is a real relationship, as should be, between politics, both writ large and small, and public health. So I'll give you an example. If you have a problem like AIDS, and I'll use AIDS again, and there's not enough money being spent on AIDS and people are dying at a quarter of all the people will die or have AIDS, and you sit and you're a public health person and you sit on the sidelines and say it's not my problem, well then you're not really good at public health. You actually have to step up to the plate and find a way to solve the problem of the politics of funding AIDS treatment and management in an entire country. That is public health, which means that you have to talk to politicians in a language they understand. You have to talk to mayors of cities and presidents of countries and all sorts of people so that they can be on your team. The best public health professionals I've ever come across, and these are the great names in public health, were all great politicians. Then you are to play the game of politics but bring health into the equation.
But you come from South Africa and you know better than most people that this has been a real issue in South Africa.
Yeah. But I'm just sort of, if we dial back to the days of apartheid where there were other issues, those of us in public health at that time, and I left South Africa because I had to make a choice between politics, real politics, and public health and politics, I chose the latter. And I was sort of in a fairly activist role at the time. But with AIDS, we were confronted first by our first president, who I think his greatest failure was AIDS. He didn't address AIDS. This is Nelson Mandela. His greatest failure, he has very few failures, but that's his failure. His successor was a classic AIDS denialist. He believed that AIDS was not caused by a virus, that it was caused by malnutrition and all sorts of other strange ideas. But at the time, the problem had exploded. And so a couple of us, and I was one of the lead people in this, got funding from the United States and developed what is now called the President's Emergency Fund for AIDS Relief, or PEPFAR. I wrote the first legislation for that. Then we decided we needed to have a research infrastructure for public health AIDS research, not people coming to look at the virus and figure out why the virus does what it does, but how do you manage a population where one out of every four people has the disease? So we got $100 million from a pharmaceutical company to build the public health infrastructure, research infrastructure for AIDS in Southern Africa in five countries. That changed the politics of AIDS immensely. If you now go around to places in Southern Africa, there's enough money to buy drugs from all sorts of sources, and there's enough research that is reasonable research for public health issues. It took us about 10 years to get to that point, but it was pure politics. I would walk the walls of Congress and try and convince Republicans that AIDS was important. AIDS in Africa was important, not in your backyard, because AIDS in Africa had real impact on the quality of life of Americans in the long range. And they understood, people on the right where money and security was important understood that. And people on the left who would do things because it felt good, it was morally the right thing to do, they were easier to convince. So it's the only legislation that went from the Clinton White House to George Bush to President Obama without money being increased. I mean, it's one of the things that USAID and the State Department see as their great success. But we had to convince two sides. And we also had to convince the Secretary of State for George Bush I, Colin Powell. And I remember sitting in a Pretoria hotel with him and with Ron Dellums, who was a person that I'd worked with at that time, convincing him that this was the right thing to do. And he then convinced Condoleezza Rice. And it now is a given that you deal with these big epidemics appropriately. But at the time we started in 97, nobody was interested. People thought that this was somebody else's problem.
Well, this is interesting. How do we get more students interested in doing what both of you are doing, which is obviously important work? Are there incentives? Do people get excited about getting involved in public health when they're teenagers?
We are seeing quite an increase in awareness of public health among undergraduates. So 20 years ago, there were not public health studies undergraduate majors. Now at Hopkins, it's the largest undergraduate major in public health studies. So, and I think at an early age, there are students who are seeing how they can give back to the community, how they can interface by working as patient navigators in the health system for patients in hospitals, how they can work with individuals in the community, work with the homeless, work with individuals in incarcerated individuals, and work overseas. So, we're a good mix of here, both national and global. And Dr. Herman knows, and has worked in both the national and the global public health arenas. But I think that our youngsters are beginning to see the importance at an earlier age. So I think the other answer to that question is that there really is such a diversity of jobs. And they range from government to non-government to nonprofit, and they're both domestic and international. So it's actually not a difficult task right now to get students interested in public health.
And what are some of the jobs, if you don't mind saying? Because there are a lot of students who watch the show, and let's say they're interested.
So a lot of it depends on their background. We certainly see those who go to health departments and they work as health educators, for instance, both locally and at a state level. We see physicians who go into jobs, say, with the Center for Disease Control, and they might be with the Epidemic Intelligence Service to try to look at epidemics and disease outbreaks as they occur. And try to solve them. We can see that there are those who go and work with nonprofit organizations in developing countries to try to provide an infrastructure, build an infrastructure in those countries. So it really depends on the background of the student. It's so diverse. At Hopkins, about a third of the public health students that get a Master of Public Health degree are physicians, nurses, or medical students. So it's also becoming a popular degree among medical students to take a break between third and fourth year. But we also have returned Peace Corps volunteers. We have public health journalists, lawyers, laboratory scientists. You know, there's a place for everyone in this mix of public health.
And would you say, Alan, that that's true around the world as
it's
well?
It's true around the world. I mean, public health is this very interesting discipline that allows you to do interesting work intellectually and also to do well, because it has a moral side to it that if your ethical compass is crooked, you won't ever be a good public health person. You may actually be technically brilliant, but you have to work within the context of community. So a good public health worker is a community health worker. That's what they all are. All of us that work in public health are community health workers. And we work to improve the quality of the lives of people in communities. So from a moral perspective, we serve the sense of our own ethical identity by being good public health people. But public health is also one of the most complicated things that you can do. So if you deal with a complex issue, intellectually, it's fascinating. You can sit for days on end doing complicated statistical programming in public health, and you'd be as happy as any math major anywhere in the world. But you have to do it in context, so you serve both these sides of your brain. And increasingly, more recently, there's been a sense that public health should also include the arts and how we think about words and think about narratives and so on. So part of the work that I did in South Africa was to think about narrative formation. How do people's identities change the way their health, how they end up being healthy or not? I'll give you a good example. If you torture somebody, and I did a whole big study on torture, and a sort of strange interest, but if you torture somebody who has a narrative of identity that is well-structured, there are very few mental health consequences. But if you torture somebody whose narrative, self-identity narrative, is kind of mixed up, they actually get post-traumatic stress disorder, depression, anxiety, all sorts of other things. So we then started understanding that narrative formation, individual narrative formation, was important for mental health. And you can count all the things that are statistically analyzed, but if you don't understand narratives, you don't understand mental health. So it's this fascinating mix of intellectual activities that make me still like being what I do.
Well, you're both good at this. Keep up the good work. Thank you both for coming on the show.
Thank you.
Thank you.
If you would like additional information about Dr. Marie Diener-West or Dr. Alan Herman, please visit jhsph.edu or ul.ac.za. If you have comments or suggestions about higher education today, please send an email to our viewer mailbox at highereducationtoday@topcolleges.com. Thank you for watching. We will continue to bring you quality discussions about important matters in today's college and university world. Please join me again for another edition of Higher Education Today. I'm Stephen Roy Goodman, and you've been watching Higher Education Today.